This is episode 124 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about our group. For March 2021, we're discussing Anxious People by Fredrik Backman. So hi, I'm Millenia in Florida.
I'm Monica in Nebraska.
And I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And we are three members of the Reading Cove Book Club. And today we're here to discuss our group's 244th pick, Anxious People by Fredrik Backman. And it was chosen by Cove member Pam, who lives in Alabama. So let's jump right in. The overall grade from the group poll was a B-. Good story. So overall, we liked it.
Yes.
I liked the flow of the story, and I liked the storyline. What I didn't like about the story is it was kind of the exception, not the rule of, oh, the armed robber is a good person and just having a whatever type, you know, like.
She was harmless.
Yes. And like, I think the majority of the time, that's not the case. So it's traumatizing.
Yeah.
Regardless of the circumstances, you put a gun to somebody's face and demand something, it's scary. So that was kind of the one thing I didn't like, but I still liked the story and I liked the writing style and I liked everything else and even the character development.
Oh, wow.
Well, I liked it because I'm a big fan of quirky, and it was very quirky. All the characters were very different. They all had, you know, some serious issues going on. But, you know, you could almost feel sort of sorry for them with all they had to deal with. But they were all different from the usual run-of-the-mill people. And you didn't really know, you know, till towards the end how much of it they were putting on and how much of it was how they really were.
As usual, this one was not my cuppa. Yeah, it was not my cup of writing style. It was like torture to reach the end. I thought all the characters were idiots, just like it said in the book. And all the comedic beats. I mean, I think maybe I laughed twice through the whole thing. It just, satire and over the top comedy just doesn't work for me at all. So I don't know. I didn't feel like it was just about what it was about. Just, you know, this person trying to rob a bank and because, you know, they've come up on hard times in life and all that. I don't know. I felt like he was trying to say more, but whatever it was he was trying to say, it just wasn't executed to reach me.
Yeah.
The two cops, the father and son cop team, was just ridiculous and laughable. You know, like I said in the group when we were discussing it, I was like, I could have done a better job with the interrogations than these two idiots.
But the witnesses weren't very helpful either. They went out of their way to be annoying.
And I found that annoying because every single one of them were the same. It's like during the interrogations, they might as well have been the same person. Well, the way they were acting.
Yeah, well, like I said, they decided to all get their story straight. But I can see how you'd be annoyed too. But, you know, it's all how you look at it.
Yeah, I'd love to see the movie version because, you know, like I've said, I loved A Man Called Uwe. But I don't know if I would have enjoyed the book. But I like the movie.
Well, I think you would have liked the book too because it's been a long time since I've, you know, read or seen either, but I think that the movie pretty much followed the book. It was, you know, well done. And my husband, who even hates subtitles, loved the movie. So, mm-hmm. You know, there's something to be said.
Yeah. I thought it could have been a commentary on suicide or, you know, strangers, how you can impact someone else's life or.
Yeah.
Shared life struggles. I don't know, but it was just boring. I wasn't there for it. Sorry. I gave it a C-.
Well, I mean, but you could see, but you know, like you say about the suicide, that it was sort of interesting how this one event mm-hmm. impacted so many people's lives in one way or another. They were, a lot of them were tied together, even though they didn't realize it till later.
Mm-hmm. So. Exactly. And their paths had crossed. It all felt a bit like too much, like very contrived.
But like I said, maybe the author was just trying to make a point.
Mm-hmm. That's what I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With the different things about the interconnections of people and how these different things, people's decisions can have ripple effects. Mm-hmm. But like I said, it wasn't a book for everybody. And I loved A Man Called Ova, as you said, but mm-hmm. I did not love this one. I liked it, but I did not love it.
Were you laughing?
Some, but I think I laughed. There were some tragic moments and there were some funny moments, just like the earlier book that mm-hmm. you just had to kind of balance one thing off with the other. I could see how you get annoyed because even though they all had their issues, there were times you wanted to, you know, scream through the book, "What is wrong with you?"
Yeah.
And especially the father and the son, they each were trying to do things differently, but the same time that they really cared about each other and were trying to protect each other. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that caused more problems than just being right up front and honest with each other.
Yeah. And then, of course, everyone in the group, I think most people said they were surprised to find the bank robber was a woman.
I know.
Was female. I was surprised by that, too.
I was, because I guess we have this stereotypical thing that
image,
image of the you know the male bank robber with the mask and the everything else. So
exactly,
when they first were talking about the person being hard up, you still could imagine a man that got taken to the cleaners in a divorce. So when it turns out it's the woman, you think, "Wow, I didn't see that."
And I think, you know, that was kind of deliberate. You know, you were supposed to assume it was a man.
Right.
And I think even criminals throughout history, I mean, you know, Bonnie and Clyde, but it's like, if there was no Clyde, Bonnie wouldn't have been the way she was. And I think, why are we looking at Clyde more harshly than Bonnie? Like, Bonnie couldn't have been that way on her own. You know,
I guess because we don't see too many female bank robbers. I mean, I'm sure there probably have been some, but you don't see too many women packing heat and going robbing banks.
You know, when they show stuff on the news and they can get pretty clear pictures of them, then yeah, that's definitely a guy, even with the disguise on. That's a guy. So
right. So what else surprised you in this? What were your theories? Because there was a running mystery about what happened to the bank robber. How come there was a pool of blood in the apartment and bank robber had disappeared, all the hostages came out. What did you guys think happened?
I really wasn't surprised by a lot of it because the fact that it was like a specific amount of money
mm-hmm. yeah.
made me think it was a woman.
Like $200.53 I want.
That got me to think, okay, it's a woman and there's a reason behind it. And then it's like, I knew they were all helping this.
Yeah, it was obvious they were all, I was thinking one of them was the bank robber. At yeah. first I was thinking, okay, it's one of these witnesses.
And,
somehow.
You know, I thought if it were a man, I don't think they would be as helpful as if it was a woman. So that's how I kind of, you know, figured. And then you had an actor in the group. So, I mean, there really wasn't a lot of twists for me. Like the, oh, gotcha moments. I was like, I kind of already figured it out, kind of. But not so much with the police helping her. So I didn't like the police coming up with the idea for her to hide in the other apartment. That part I didn't see.
Yeah, the father cop, daddy cop.
Yeah, I didn't see that coming either.
That was just crazy. And so he proceeds to just waste everybody's time.
Right.
That's why I couldn't take this seriously. It was kind of too over the top for me. It's like one of those comedies that are just like slapstick, obvious stuff.
Yeah, I thought it was funny, the guy who was the actor who went around, you know, causing problems so people wouldn't pay for the apartment.
Yeah, so they can, I thought,
that's just so crazy.
Yeah. they can drive the price down.
Right. I thought, well, there's got to be somebody for everything. But that guy was, he was a really wackadoodle.
Yeah, and everybody's a comedian.
I know.
Everyone in the apartment viewing just so happens to be a comedian.
Well, except for Estelle. You know, she was the sweet one that, you know, was
who?
Looking
dirty. Which one?
Estelle. You know,
Estelle. Yeah.
She really was. She was the motherly type. Mm-hmm. But everybody else is pretty funny, yes.
Okay, any favorite characters?
Well, Estelle, as I said, because she just, you know, had this special love for people. You know, she didn't really have any agenda, and she tried to play like it was something different, but just that way that people wouldn't know how it really was, and she could just find somebody that she would think would be worthy of having the apartment that she loved so much.
I think my favorite character was the dad cop, and just because he reminded me of my dad, because my dad would be one of those, you know, you weren't supposed to do this. However, there are circumstances, you know, I got an
mitigating
idea.
Mitigating circumstances.
Let's do this instead, and you can get away with it.
How about, I don't remember the names now, but the one who, the rich lady who was just going to the viewings to interact with people? Or why was she there? I don't remember, but it was a weird reason. She was going to a therapist, and then she started going to apartment viewings.
Yeah, I think because she wasn't very good with people. She was, I think, too much of an introvert and too much, like, all about
a
her
snob.
Career. Didn't have any outside things, so I think the therapist wanted her to get out and interact more with people, so that was the way she could do it.
Yeah, and she was a real snob.
Yes, she was. You know, she had nice clothes, nice everything, so she thought she was better than all these people that, you know, she had worked hard and she had gotten ahead, and these other people were just beneath her, which was
exactly
sort of sad because she ended up, you know,
with the actor.
That was really weird too, but I mean, before that, she pretty much, you know, led a pretty lonely life. She was successful, but at what price? But yeah, then she ended up with this wackadoodle actor. That's, you know, really unexpected too.
I think it'd be interesting if Fredrik Backman wrote this as a serious drama, like a thriller, a crime thriller.
Yeah.
I would like to read that book.
See, I think he was trying to do too many points. Like, if you run on bad luck and you lose housing, then you can get your kids taken away from you. And that's a bad thing. Mm-hmm. And then the thing with where they, I don't really know the whole financial situation of the people that scammed people on that. So I don't even know what that's called, but that part of it. And then, you know, the rich lady who has all the money, but then doesn't really, that has a lonely life. So I think he's trying to hit too many points.
Yeah, through all the characters.
Yeah.
And the two lesbian ladies, the one that was pregnant.
Right.
And, of course, the two who constantly are buying and flipping. Right. And I think the wife didn't want to do it anymore. It was all the husband's thing.
Yeah, it was all about the husband. She did it because she felt guilty because they had put her career first. Mm-hmm. And then when it finally got to a point where she could retire and it could be his turn, it was too late. You know,
right.
He was too old to really make anything. So I think she pretty much did stuff out of guilt, you know, to make him happy because she felt bad that, you know, he'd never been able to achieve his true dreams as she had. So this was a way of assuaging her guilt, even though I think eventually she came clean and said, you know, I'm tired of doing this.
Yeah. Yeah, so I agree with Monica. I think too many things happening.
Too many issues. I probably would have given it a or something if maybe he'd narrowed it down just a little bit more. There, you know, maybe one less issue at least.
Right. A little more focus, I guess. But, you know, we had several people in the group who really liked it. I know Pam chose it and she really liked it. Dar really liked it. Yeah, so B- is a good grade.
Yes, it's a good grade.
Mm-hmm. And with him, with that book having too many issues, I think, like, when I read Bear Town, that was, well, it's a hockey team. It could be any sports team because hockey was big in their town. And it's about, you know, a hockey player raping a girl. And then you don't want to lose a team. You don't want to lose your best player. You don't want to. So it's kind of like how sports and athletes kind of get a free pass mm-hmm. when it comes to that type of thing. So that, I mean, that was the point of the whole book. So it's one main issue.
Oh, yeah, one main focus. You're right, Monica.
So I was surprised that there were so many issues in one book. Because, yeah. you know, I read Beartown and I read the sequel. I really enjoyed those two books, and those are the only two books so far, but I wanted to read more, which is why I voted for Anxious People, because I'm like, well, you know, I like Beartown, so.
Yeah. Well, this book is wildly popular. All his books are.
Oh, yeah.
So there is a huge audience for his type of storytelling, for sure, but I think I'll pass on any future books. I'll stick to the movies based on his books.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so that's our discussion of Anxious People. We want to thank our listeners for tuning in. As always, please leave us your comments below and let us know what you thought about the book. And stay tuned for our next episode, where we'll be discussing Conjure Women by Afia Adekora. See you next time. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.